In this unit, we will be analyzing Georgia's participation in important events that occurred from World War I through the Great Depression. Initially, Georgians were rather indifferent to the events of World War I. However, when the United States did enter the war on April 6, 1917, war sentiment shifted to one of panic and suspicion. Georgia provided more military training camps for the war effort than any other state. After the war, Americans celebrated the victory throughout the nation. In this era, known as the Roaring Twenties, many Americans listened to jazz, danced the Charleston, and invested and hit it big in the stock market. However, these good times were not happening for most Georgians. Primarily a rural state, Georgia was suffering through one of the worst droughts in its history. Additionally, a tiny insect called the boll weevil was devastating Georgia's most important crop, cotton. While Georgia was suffering through a mini depression during the 1920s, after the stock market crash of 1929, America's Great Depression hit the nation with devastating outcomes throughout the next decade. Georgia continued to experience more hard times during the Great Depression. In 1933, part-time Georgia resident Franklin Roosevelt became president. President Roosevelt and his brain trust developed several New Deal programs that directly affected Georgia. However, Georgia's governor Eugene Talmadge was against the interference of the federal government in state policies and fought against the New Deal programs. Interestingly, both Roosevelt and Talmadge, though on opposite ends of the political spectrum, were popular among Georgians, and the voters of the state helped elect them both to multiple terms. For Standard A, we will provide a quick overview of World War I and briefly describe Georgia's contributions to it. At the beginning of the 20th century, European countries did not trust each other, and feelings of nationalism fueled anger and hatred in the region. All of Europe was a powder keg waiting to explode over boundary disputes, resentment, and hunger for land. This all resulted in the formation of alliances. In 1882, Germany, Italy, and Austria-Hungary joined to form the Triple Alliance. In 1907, France, Russia, and Britain formed the Triple Entente. On June 28, 1914, Archduke Franz Ferdinand and his wife, the Duchess Sophie, were assassinated by a Serbian nationalist named Gavrilo Princip, who was associated with the Black Hand terrorist group. This assassination sent shockwaves throughout Europe, igniting the war. Austria-Hungary declared war on Serbia because it blamed the Serbian government for the killings of Ferdinand and his wife. The alliances forced countries to take sides. Russia sent troops to help Serbia. This led to Germany declaring war on Russia, which also meant war with France. And this led to England declaring war on Germany. In the end, over 30 nations would be involved in this global conflict that would become known as the Great War or World War I. Germany moved troops into France, but the advancement stopped short at the Marne River, just 25 miles outside of Paris. Both sides dug in, developing a 400-mile-long network of trenches that stretched from the North Sea to Switzerland along the Western Front. Germany and Russia also squared off along the Eastern Front that stretched from the Black Sea to the Baltic Sea. It was a global war, a war of destruction, a war of innovation, a war of production, a war of propaganda, and a war that changed the world and shaped the 20th century. Though President Woodrow Wilson and the United States wanted to avoid getting involved, several events would lead the United States to join the Allies late in the war. On May 7, 1915, the British passenger ship Lusitania was sunk by a German U-boat. This outraged Americans because nearly 1,200 people, including 128 American citizens, were killed. The German U-boats would continue to attack passenger ships. The Zimmermann telegram further angered Americans when they learned that the German Foreign Minister, Arthur Zimmermann, had sent a note to Mexico proposing an alliance against the United States and promising that Germany would help Mexico gain back the areas that they had lost to the United States during the Mexican-American War. American newspapers published the information in March. The United States Congress declared war a month later on April 6, 1917. The United States entering the war would turn the tide in favor of the Allies. The war would come to an end on the 11th day of the 11th month at the 11th hour in 1918, a day that would become known as Armistice Day and is now celebrated as Veterans Day. Since the United States did not get involved until late in the war, Georgians were largely indifferent towards it when it first began. Once in, Georgia played a significant role. Georgia had five major federal forts and more military training facilities than any other state. These forts and camps included Camp Benning, which is today called Fort Benning, Fort McPherson, and Camp Gordon. During the war, a German submarine crew was imprisoned at Fort McPherson. The training camps contributed more than 100,000 men and women to the war effort. Georgians bought war bonds to pay for the war and raised victory gardens to help feed troops. Georgia textile mills made fabric for military uniforms. Railroads carried arms, ammunition, and soldiers to ports where ships waited to sail for Europe. Women served in the Red Cross and provided support. Ultimately, Georgia lost 3,000 young people from all over the state who died in an effort to make the world safe for democracy. In Standard B, we briefly explain economic factors that resulted in the Great Depression. These include the boll weevil and drought. Georgia experienced an agricultural economic downturn in the years prior to the Great Depression. For Georgians, the 20s were not a time of abundance. A small, grayish, long-snouted beetle, the boll weevil, was destroying the primary source of income for many Georgia farmers. The boll weevil came from Mexico and moved through Texas and into southern states during the late 1800s. It appeared in southwest Georgia in 1918 and quickly spread across the state, destroying thousands of acres of cotton. Georgia would also experience a severe drought in 1925. The invasion of the boll weevil and terrible droughts caused farmers to experience serious loss of income and need to examine agricultural practices. The impact of the boll weevil cut Georgia's cotton production in half from 1914 to 1923. It caused many African Americans to move to cities and to the north. In fact, over 375,000 farm workers left Georgia between 1920 and 1925. Many blacks moved to northern industrial cities such as Chicago and Detroit, hoping to find work in factories and assembly plants. Banks that had loaned the farmers money also took huge losses. Many farm-related businesses were forced to close, and it forced Georgians to diversify their economy. With the damage caused by the boll weevil and the droughts, Georgia began to suffer from depression long before the rest of the United States. By 1929, the stock market was unstable. Banks were starting to close, and factories were laying off workers. On October 29, 1929, a day that became known as Black Tuesday, the stock market crashed, with over 16 million shares of stock being unloaded. Billions of dollars were lost. For instance, a share of United States Steel that had sold for $262 dropped to $22. Montgomery Ward stock sank from $138 to $4 a share. General Motors stock plunged from $78 to $8 a share. Other economic factors contributing to the United States Great Depression included overproduction of agricultural goods. Midwestern farmers produced record numbers of agricultural products. However, this overproduction led to a tremendous drop in the price of agricultural products and dramatically limited the profit margins of farmers. Failure of banks. Thousands of banks were forced to close as people formed long lines in desperate attempt to withdraw their life savings. Banks that did manage to stay open became more conservative in lending money to borrowers and businesses, further keeping the country in an economic crisis. Reduction in consumer purchasing. In what became a vicious cycle, after the stock market crash and due to other economic fears, the average consumer stopped purchasing goods. When people stopped buying products, companies in turn lowered their production rates. With lower production rates, many consumers lost their jobs and had no money to spend. with an unemployment rate of 25%, this further lessened the purchasing power of the average consumer. The Dust Bowl. This was a name given to the drought-stricken Southern Plains region of the United States, which suffered severe dust storms during a dry period in the 1930s. As high winds and choking dust swept the region from Texas to Nebraska, people and livestock were killed and crops failed across the entire region. In Standard C, we describe Eugene Talmadge's opposition to the New Deal programs. Eugene Talmadge supported farmers and campaigned largely in rural areas. He was elected governor in 1933. He was another white supremacist. He fought against Roosevelt's New Deal policies, especially those that aided blacks. As Georgia's governor, Talmadge's lack of cooperation in the implementation of the New Deal programs reflected his opposition of increased federal spending and economic regulation by the federal government. He did not support federal relief programs, especially those that paid black employees as much as whites. He was opposed to relief efforts, public welfare, and federal assistance programs that tried to rid the state of New Deal programs. He won re-election to second term in 1934 by a landslide margin. However, the federal government took over New Deal programs in Georgia. Talmadge was quick to fire officials who disagreed with him. Talmadge was elected for a third term after Urith Rivers served two terms. At that time, the governors were not allowed to serve more than two consecutive terms. By this time, he softened his anti-Roosevelt stand and began to use modified versions of the New Deal legislation. Georgia schools lost their accreditation from the Southern Association of Colleges and Schools because of Talmadge's racist actions in firing several school leaders who had planned to integrate the Teachers College in Statesboro, which is now known as Georgia Southern. Talmadge was not reelected in 1942, but was again reelected to a fourth term in 1946. However, he died before taking office. In Standard D, we discuss President Roosevelt's ties to Georgia, including his visits to Warm Springs and his impact on the state. Seeking treatment for his polio condition, Roosevelt began a years-long relationship with the small community of Warm Springs and with the state of Georgia. Roosevelt had been struck with polio in 1921, a contagious virus that can cause paralysis and even prove deadly. He considered Georgia his second home and spent his summers at what became known as the Little White House in Warm Springs, Georgia, which he had built in 1932. Georgians enthusiastically supported their adopted son as President of the United States. As a result of his time spent in rural Georgia, he witnessed firsthand the poverty that engulfed the state during the late 1920s and early 1930s. As president, he created several New Deal programs, including the Agricultural Adjustment Administration, AAA, and the Rural Electrification Administration, REA, which were clearly impacted by his association with rural Georgia. During his fourth term, Roosevelt died at his Warm Springs home from a stroke. He had just returned from the Yalta meeting with Churchill and Stalin. He was sitting for a portrait on April 24, 1945. Suddenly, the president put his hand to his head and said, "I have a terrific headache." At 5:48 p.m., a stunned nation was told that the man who had led the country through recovery from depression, the New Deal, and to the brink of victory in the Second World War was dead. A massive stroke had killed him while an artist was painting his portrait. In the last standard of this unit, we will examine the effects of the New Deal in terms of the impact of the Civilian Conservation Corps, Agricultural Adjustment Act, Rural Electrification Administration, and Social Security Administration. Though Georgia voters supported Governor Eugene Talmadge in several elections, even though he was a critic of the New Deal, they also overwhelmingly supported President Franklin Roosevelt and his New Deal programs throughout the Great Depression. The New Deal programs provided aid and support to many Georgians. Though these programs did not end the Great Depression, they helped many Georgians and other Americans cope during the difficult economic times. In the end, World War II would pull the country out of the Great Depression, and Americans would rally to victory. Beginning in 1933, the Civilian Conservation Corps, CCC, had a major impact on the state and nation. It was an agency operated by the Army. The purpose of the program was to hire unemployed young men just out of high school to work on public service projects. It established close to 1,500 camps across the country. Some of these projects included erosion control, flood prevention, and public parks. Men who volunteered for this service signed 6-month contracts and were provided room and board. In addition, they also received $30 a month, $22 to $25 of which had to be sent back to their families. Of all the New Deal programs, this was probably the most successful and popular. Over the 9 years it was in existence, over 3 million young men worked in the program and planted millions of trees throughout the country and improved over 800 national and state parks throughout the country as well. Roosevelt had an interest in bringing electricity to all parts of the country. During President Roosevelt's first night at Warm Springs, Georgia, he was sitting on his porch trying to catch a breeze on a hot, sultry summer night. He noticed that no lights were showing from neighboring farms. He also noticed that his electric bill was substantially higher than the bill he paid for his mansion in New York. So, on May 11, 1935, he signed into law the act creating the Rural Electrification Administration. Though many members of Congress and state governors such as Georgia's Eugene Talmadge fought against the program, fearing it would lead to socialism, many farmers benefited from it. The Rural Electrification Act was passed by Congress in 1936. According to the New Deal Network, by 1939 there was a 25% increase in the number of rural households that had electricity and for a reasonable price. The lights were coming on in Georgia and the rest of the nation slowly but surely. In addition, electrical outlets and electrical appliances were making life much easier and more enjoyable. The basic premise of the Agricultural Adjustment Act, AAA, of 1933 was that since so many farmers continued to grow crops such as cotton and tobacco during the Depression, which drove the price of these products down, the federal government offered to pay farmers not to grow these crops. This caused the price of agricultural products to rise, which helped farmers make more money and eliminate surplus production. Yet in many cases, this policy did more harm than good for sharecroppers and tenant farmers. Though the government told the landowner that the payments should be distributed to those who lived on and worked the land, many landowners simply kept the money for themselves. The government could not enforce this rule, and as a result, many of the people who needed this aid never received it. Often, since the sharecropper or tenant farmer could not work the land, they were simply removed. This was one of the factors that led to urbanization and the end of sharecropping and tenant farming in the state. Another program that had a lasting effect on Georgia was the Social Security Administration, SSA. Until 1935, those who were too old or unable to work were dependent on the charity of others. The Social Security Administration offers benefits for those over 65, those who are disabled, or those who are the survivors of a beneficiary who has died. This program is one of the longest running of the New Deal, and today most Georgians are connected to the SSA either through paying Social Security taxes or receiving Social Security benefits.